we know we have to remember.
It's very important to not forget the history.
We have to constantly remind ourselves that these things happened and that they could happen again.
I remember, as it were, yesterday.
I remember in the morning pulling the curtains back and seeing someone standing there with a gun.
I heard the shots.
My father was killed.
My brother died.
We saw the tanks in the village. We saw the helicopters overhead, and we knew this was a major act of terrorism, and we were in the middle of it.
This was the first time terrorism was seen on the worldwide stage.
And this was the Olympic Games, and hey, this wasn't right.
There is so much to tell. But it was comfortable for them to cover up all those very difficult facts.
Because we knew it was not a simple case, it was much more complicated. Let us not forget what happened here in 1972, so that it will never happen again.
It was the first time the Summer Olympics were held in Germany. Adolf Hitler and the Nazis used the 1936 Games to promote their ideals of racial supremacy and anti-Semitism. Games went on, Hitler celebrated, and then led the world into a devastating war and the murder of 6 million Jews. Thirty-six years later, the Olympics were back in Germany.
In Munich, we had the second Summer Olympics here in Germany, and each day we go there to the Olympic area. It was fabulous. It was a wonderful feeling to represent a free and democratic country.
The Olympics going back to Germany for the first time since before World War II, since before the Holocaust, was significant. It was an opportunity to present a different face of Germany, not a martial Germany, but a peaceful Germany.
The Germans were so keen to please. You know, the post-war sort of mentality, and security was slack, and friendship was everywhere, and there was just the friendly games. That's how they wanted it to be.
The Germans had really gone out of their way to make these games perfect.
The Olympic Village in Munich was just a place that was mesmerizing, because you saw all these people from the whole world, and everybody was talking and everybody was walking and asking and playing together and watching movies together, you know, exactly what the Olympic Village should be like.
Anki Spitzer was there with her new husband, Andre, the fencing coach for the Israeli Olympic team.
One day, we were in the village, and my husband said, "Hey, that's the Lebanese fencing team. I'm going to talk to them." And I said to him, "Are you out of your mind? Israel is in a state of war with Lebanon." And he said, "Anki, this is the Olympics. Here it is possible." And I stayed a little bit behind, and he went towards them. And they shook hands, and they were talking about the results and how wonderful it was there and everything. And he came to me and he said, "You see, Anki, this is the Olympics. Here there are no borders. Here there is no war. You know, this is what it is all about."
Forget what happened 36 years ago. This is the new Germany. And to a certain extent, in so doing, they made the games vulnerable. There wasn't enough security.
The games were exciting. The facilities were terrific. They had so many people helping you, guiding you, advising you. Everything was perfect. Everything worked on time. And it was just marvelous. And then this happened.
It was the sixth time Israel had participated in the Olympics since becoming a nation in 1948.
It was a young, almost a baby country. And for the generation that grew up then, it was the first steps of being a normal nation. Holocaust survivors or kids of Holocaust survivors. And for them, it was a big thing going over there as the Jewish athletes coming with their heads up to join the Olympic Games within Germany. It was a big thing.
It was about 4 or 5 in the morning, and I heard the shots. And I thought to myself, I've been out here several days. That's not a door slamming. That's a gun.
The call came from my assistant, and she said, something's going on, Neil. I think you ought to get dressed and head to the Olympic Village. I said, what's happening? And she said, well, we don't know, but something's going on at the Israeli compound.
Earlier, 8 Palestinians, dressed as athletes, carrying guns and hand grenades in their gym bags, were standing outside the Olympic Village, looking to get in.
They came to the wall. In the same minute, there was a group of Americans coming back from a party, accidentally met the Palestinian fighters in the wall. And they help each other to jump over the wall, and they are laughing, and the Americans even take the bags full of guns and hand bombs, but they don't know exactly what's happened.
Once over the fence, the Palestinians made their way into the building at 31 Connolly Strasse. They broke into one of the dorm rooms and were confronted by Israeli wrestling coach Moshe Weinberg, who tried to fight them off. The Palestinians stopped him with a gun.
They shot him through his face. He just got shot here in the face. You know, we saw all these pictures.
Weinberg survived and became the first hostage.
They asked him, where are all the Israelis? Where? In which apartment? And he took them to the third apartment, because in the third apartment were all the strong guys, like Romano and all the weightlifters and the wrestlers and everything. He took them there. And they took all of them back to the first building where the coaches were, my husband was. And there they were kept hostage.
The Palestinians now had 11 Israeli hostages. Among them, the gravely injured Moshe Weinberg, who again went after his captors. He was joined by weightlifter Yosef Romano. Weinberg knocked one Palestinian unconscious and slashed another with a knife. Romano was able to wound a third, but the Palestinians regained control, shooting the two Israelis, killing Weinberg. Night gave way to dawn, and word of the attack began to make its way through the Olympic Village.
Somewhere around 5 o'clock in the morning, 6 o'clock, very early, I get a call, and it's from Howard Cosell. And he said, my young friend, you listen closely to me. Arab terrorists have invaded the Israeli compound. And I'm thinking, you know, what is, you know, yeah, right, Howard, leave me alone, not funny. And I hung up the phone.
Around 6 a.m., the press began covering the story.
There were a whole bunch of us about 90 yards from the entrance to the Israeli compound.
At 7:40 a.m., the hostage takers released their ransom letter.
They said that they wanted 200 Palestinian prisoners freed from the prison. And if they wouldn't get them free, then they would start killing the Israelis, one after the other.
Their deadline, 9 a.m. The deadline came and went. Negotiators pushed the deadline back to noon, then to 1 p.m., then 3 p.m. At 4 p.m., German Foreign Minister Hans-Dietrich Genscher offered himself as a hostage in exchange for the Israelis. The leader of the Palestinians, refused. German negotiators demanded to see the captive Israelis.
First the curtain was opened and then the window was opened, and suddenly I see my husband standing in front of the window. He could speak German, so he was also the spokesman of the hostages to the crisis team that was gathered downstairs. I could see that he was tied with his hands behind his back, and he didn't have his glasses on. And I found it so humiliating, because I knew that he couldn't see without his glasses on, and he was standing there in his undershirt. Afterwards, I asked what was the conversation all about, you know, to the people that, like, to the Minister of Interior from the Germans, and all the other people were gathered there. And they said, they asked him, what is happening inside? And he said, everybody is okay except for one. And then they asked, who is the one and what happened to him? And Andrei was referring to Yossi Romano, who had been shot. But before he had the chance to say that, you could see that he was hit on live television, you know, hit with the butt of the rifle on his back. And then they just pushed him back into the room and they closed the curtains, they closed the windows. And that was really the last time that I saw my husband, you know, alive.
Olympic officials and the German security forces had no idea what to do. They were completely unprepared, untrained, and unequipped.
They tried to rescue them, and they had all kinds of things that they were doing there, you know, like sending policemen dressed up like athletes.
The Germans were giving serious thought to storming the rooms where the Israelis were being held, and the element of surprise being important, they dressed in tracksuits. There was one dressed in a blue tracksuit, another was in a red tracksuit, carrying automatic weapons. Now, the control room for ABC was right there. All they had to do was put a little extension wire, you know, probably 300 feet, you know, would be like photographing a ball player in the outfield.
Cameras broadcast live as the police moved in.
So I could see these policemen dressed up as athletes, you know, with their guns on the rooftops. Also, the terrorists could see it because they were also watching TV.
When police realized their mistake, they called off the operation and tried to calm the Palestinians. After many hours of tense negotiations, the Palestinians and Germans finally came to an agreement. The terrorists and their captives were to be flown to Cairo for further negotiations on Arab ground.
Why Egypt? Because these Israelis will arrive to the Arab countries, they will be arrested as citizens of an enemy country. So, and after that, the job of the fighters will be finished.
At some point, a bus arrives, and we can barely make out shadows of people being led into a bus.
I remember my mother saying, that's a good sign when they're being taken out, all the hostages, when they're taking them out. I said, no, it's not a good sign. I didn't believe that they will be taken to an Arab country, and then after 5 or 10 years, they will be exchanged with other prisoners. I said, that's not going to happen.
The buses took the Palestinians and their hostages to helicopters waiting nearby.
I can remember personally during this night to hear the helicopters starting, and we knew who is inside there.
It was like 10:30 at night, and I only could see the two helicopters, and they were flying to this small airfield that hadn't been used for a long time. Many times at night I still see these helicopters in the air. And I knew that that was it. All the time that they are in the Olympic Village and the focus of the world is there, they have a chance. If they are being taken to some way out, small airfield, that's the end of them. What the Germans want is just to continue with their fun games. And this is bothering them. You know, there is this drama taking place, and they want to take the drama out of the Olympic Village so that life can go on.
They move with the helicopters to the airport. It's a military airport. the Germans was prepared to attack them when they enter.
And that is where a so-called plane was waiting to take the hostages and the terrorists to an Arab country.
Waiting at the airport was a Boeing 727. Inside, German police officers dressed as flight crew. Around the airport, German snipers. And just outside the entrance gates, 50 uniformed policemen. Inside the control tower, the crisis command team. Standing nearby was the head of Israeli intelligence, Zvi Zamir, authorized only as an observer. These excerpts are from his official report to Defense Secretary Moshe Dayan and Prime Minister Golda Meir on September 6th. His first impression was that the operation was going well.
When they arrived, two of the Palestinians went to the civilian plane to be sure that nothing happened. And the mistake was that they went alone without taking hostages with them. This is from Palestinian point of view. So on their way back, the German snipers killed them. And these two was the leaders of the operation.
Zamir's recollection was different. One terrorist killed immediately, while the second survived long enough to continue fighting.
Immediately, the other Palestinian fighter shoot back. And there was a military exchange shooting for 3 hours.
And the terrorists, they shot all the lights at the airport, so it was pitch dark. And nobody knew what was going on. And you could only hear on television, you could hear the firing of the rifles.
Zamir reported one dissolution after another. Police snipers armed with only handguns. Fighters more numerous than expected. Lack of reinforcements. Communications and logistics breakdowns.
At one point, there was a huge explosion. And you could see flames and everything. So one of the helicopters was set alight. They threw hand grenades in there. And nobody could say what was happening. And I was, you know, I said, what is going on? You know, who is fighting who there?
The first information that the hostages are liberated.
There was a certain time that we were sure that the rescue operation was successful. So like for 1 hour, everybody in Israel was very happy.
The official spokesman of the German government said that on national television. All the Israelis are saved and all the terrorists are killed.
I'm very glad that as far as we can see now, this police action was successful.
So pandemonium broke out in my house. You know, my father opened the champagne bottle and then everybody was starting to call and kiss and blah, blah, blah. I said, no. I said, I am not convinced of anything until I hear Andre.
I mean, if all that comes out as we hope, I think it will be forgotten after a few weeks.
And I waited. It was already midnight. They said, maybe a few of them are wounded, so wait patiently. At 1 o'clock in the morning I called, at 1:30, and at 2 o'clock, and at 2:30. And every time the story became worse, they said maybe some of them are killed, maybe some of them are wounded. Nobody knew what was going on. At 3 o'clock I called again, and then afterwards I didn't have to call, because at 3:10 in the morning, Jim McKay came on.
Our worst fears have been realized tonight. They have now said that there were 11 hostages. Two were killed in their rooms yesterday morning. 9 were killed at the airport tonight. They're all gone.
To this day, I think those were the saddest words I have ever heard spoken on any event that I ever covered. That's for sure.
The whole city of Munich, I would say, the whole Germany was in a deep shock. It was a shock for us personally. It was a personal shock.
9 Israelis, along with German policeman Anton Fliegerbauer, were killed in the firefight at Fürstenfeldbruck Airport. the Olympics stopped briefly for a memorial service for the slain Israelis.
Look, it was just surreal. We were young athletes, and here we were right next door to a major international tragedy. So I think the enormity was too great for us, honestly, at that stage.
We knew of acts of terrorism, but not in this context. Not coming in for no reason, taking 11 innocent athletes' lives.
It's the first time outside the border of Israel that a terror attack took place. They were purely civilians that didn't do anything to anyone.
Something was totally destroyed. You can really do so much harm to something which is trying to bring people together, talking about peace and friendship, and you just do the contrary.
Every civilized person recoils in horror.
Avery Brundage gave a speech in the stadium and declared that the games will go on.
Protesters marched against the decision.
How can the games go on after a tragedy like this? We thought it was terrible and disgusting and disrespectful, typical of what a crusty old Avery Brundage would do.
The games must go on, and we must.
Well, you know, 42 years later, that's the way we think now. If they had stopped the games, the terrorists would have won.
I came back to the Olympic Village. It was like surrealistic. On the right and on the left, I'm looking, and people are training. You know, there's an athletic field there. And I still remember thinking, you know, 11 people were murdered. And everybody is still, you know, going on with the Olympics.
The 20th Olympiad continued. The surviving members of the Israeli teams went home. But for the families of the victims, that decision to go forward turned a blind eye to what happened.
After the ceremony, they asked those that survived, there are a number of people that survived of the Israeli athletes, if they could go back to the rooms of those that were killed and gather their belongings. So I said, okay, I'll pick up Andre's stuff. And they said, no, you cannot go there, because in his room, they were kept hostage. And that's where they killed Yossi Romano, in that room. And I said, yes, but I will go there. I want to see the place where my husband spent the last hours of his life. So I went back to the apartment and I opened the door. There is a staircase and I had to go up because he was on the second floor. And the blood was coming down where they had shot Romano. And I went up to the room and I stood there. There were four big holes in the wall where they had shot the rifle. I cannot even describe the chaos that was in that room. Eight people had been tied with their hands and their legs to the table, to the bed. They didn't let them go to the bathroom. There, Yossi Romano was shot. It was blood all over the place. I never forget that moment that my husband believed so much in the Olympic idea, the Olympic ideals. That's, he believed in it. And for this terrible tragedy to happen afterwards, it doesn't go together with the Olympic Games, it doesn't.
Rael Othman recalls the events of September 5th from the Palestinian perspective.
One of the reasons why they did it is to introduce the Palestinian case, issue, problems to the world.
When this took place, the international community and the world did not pay attention, unfortunately, to the Palestinian case and the demands to live in freedom and independently. But after that event, most of the international community paid attention.
Manage most of our goals in Munich activity. Okay, we didn't release the prisoners, but we manage all of our goals that we want from Munich activity. This is what Abu Iyad himself said, and this is the highest person who are responsible for this activity.
The Palestinians never wanted to use force or violence as a tool only for the sake of using it. All of the struggle since 1965 and until today has been taking place in order to get freedom for our people.
There was a very high restriction to the people who entered, to the Palestinians, not to be violent, not to kill any of the hostages.
You're talking here about clear demands and conditions that would lead to a solution.
It was a clear order from the leadership in different levels that you have to go and negotiate to release 236 prisoners.
We know that force was used back then and there were victims on both sides.
But killing was the last thing that they can do.
That interpretation of history is at odds with the evidence revealed since the events of 72.
באחד המסמכים לפני 20 שנה קיבלנו תמונות פתולוגיות קשות מאוד. אנקי ואני ישבנו אחד מול השנייה ואמרנו, אנקי, אני לא מסוגלת להראות את זה למשפחות. לא מסוגלת. תמונות קשות, קשות, קשות.
My dad was saw the very difficult pictures of what happened in this room. And when I used to ask him, what did you see in those pictures? It's the first time they saw him crying. He told me, promise me that you will never ask to see those pictures.
These pictures, revealed for the first time some 20 years after the attack, showed details far more cruel and painful than anyone had been led to believe. Yosef Romano did not die immediately after being shot. As he lay on the floor, the Palestinians castrated him and left him to bleed to death in front of his teammates.
Justice has to be done for these people because they didn't come with guns. They were not on the battlefield. They were not trying to fight an enemy. They came to the peaceful, joyful brotherhood games in Munich. And this is what happened to them. This is how they spent the last hours in fear and being humiliated, being tortured, being castrated. Somebody is going to take responsibility for what happened to these people in the middle of the Olympic Village. Tell me what happened. I think I have the right to know.
Upon hearing the news of torture used during the Munich attacks, Ziad Zayad responded with the following letter. Rael Othman did not reply when asked for comment.
Slowly we are finding out who is involved and what is happening. And we are just overwhelmed by all the new information. So if you think that I can say, let me go home, let me go, you know, finish this whole thing. No, I owe it not only to these 11 athletes, but also to my daughter and also to the next generation. No. We are not going home until we get the full truth, until people who are responsible take the responsibility. The German government kept saying to me, we don't have any information. Now, I'm from Holland, and I know the German mentality. Everything is documented, every word, everything is organized, and so on. So I said, it cannot be that you don't have this information. Of course, the Bavarian government, the federal government, everybody had been lying about the fact that they didn't have the information. And how did I find out? 20 years after knocking at every door, at every possible venue, don't even ask me what I did in order to get that information. But I could not get the official documents. 20 years afterwards, I gave an interview for the German television. And I'm talking about that we are not getting all the information. After I got back to Israel, somebody called from the archives of the court, and he sent me 80 pages of the investigation and everything. And he said, there are thousands of documents that they haven't given to you. I went to the Minister of Foreign Affairs. I didn't show him that I had only 80 pages. I said, I have most of the material. Now I want all of it. It took 2 full months in the summer with questions in the parliament in Germany, and people were writing about it and everything. But in the end, on the 28th of August, I'll never forget, in 92, they invited us to come to Munich, to the archives. And I mean, 3 walls full of files, 900 forensic pictures, thousands of papers, which came out. Is only a very, very small part of what is there. There is much more.
The years that followed did not dim the memories nor diminish the pain for the victims' families. After Yosef Romano's death, his wife Ilana was left alone to raise their 3 daughters.
Oshrat, Rucha, and Shlomit igiu elai v'ani hayti b'mita. והסתכלתי אליהם ואמרתי לקום, להראות שאני חזקה, או פשוט לתת לזמן לעשות את שלו.
When I was 6 and a half, I was very proud that my father going to represent Israel. It was really shocked that, to understand that he came back on coffin.
ומפחדות לבכות לידי בשביל לא לפגוע בי. לקחתי אותם אליי, חיבקתי ואמרתי להם, קרה דבר נורא. אבא נרצח באולימפיאדת מינכן. ואני מבטיחה שאת הזכר של אבא לא נשכח לעולם. כל העולם ידע מי היה אבא שלכם, יוסף רומנו.
For me, I'm living this moment every day.
Michal Shahar's father was Kahat Shor, the shooting coach for the 72 Israeli Olympic team.
I was at home in the morning. I open, like always, the news, and they're talking about the athletes at Munich. At this point, I didn't know that my father was one of them. Later in the day, somebody found me from the Olympic team in Israel, and they told me that my father was one of them. I was hoping that my father, it was a mistake.
Kahat Shor died at the airport.
My home, where I live, it's not far, it's 2 minutes from the grave of my father. So I'm thinking of him every week. My mother, which is 90, she's still living, and she also speaks every day of him.
My brother, his name was Mark, from Russia.
Mark Slavin faced anti-Semitic street violence in the Soviet Union until he made the Russian Olympic team at age 17. His sister was born 2 years after his death.
He got into the Russian Olympic team in 72. But his dream was to join to the Israeli team and to represent Jewish people. All my family came to Israel because of him, on May 72, because of my brother. So for him to join the Israeli team was wow. He said to my dad, even if nothing will happen, I was there. I was there. That was his dream.
For 2 months, I walked around, you know, full of anger, hatred. I didn't know what to do. I was full of hatred. After 2 months, I said to myself, how am I going to raise my daughter if I'm full of hate? I have to make a change.
It's very important to have a place which everybody could remember.
שיזכור. צריך לזכור את בניה של התנועה האולימפית שנרצחו במינכן למען הצדק ההיסטורי.
The surviving relatives have been struggling for over 4 decades to memorialize the tragedy of 72.
I went with Ilana and Anki, the three of us, to the Olympic Games of Montreal in 76. This was the first time that we tried to make a change, moment of silence. But as you know, nothing happened.
When I beginning, I say, okay, 2 years, 4 years, one Olympic, and the second, and the third, and now 10.
We have been to all the Olympics, and every time the tune changed, first, they accused me of bringing politics into the Olympics. I said, I'm bringing politics into the Olympics. I said, if you don't want to say that they were Israelis or Jews, you know, whatever, if you don't want to say that, then just say that 11 athletes who were part of the Olympic family were murdered, brutally murdered and tortured in the Olympic village. And then the tune changed. In Athens in 2004, they said, that is too early. I said, what is this too early? What do you want me to come with a stick and being pushed in a wheelchair and then finally you're going to do it, you know? And then we went into London and in London they said, it is not appropriate to remember something so sad at the glorious fun opening ceremony.
Ladies and gentlemen, please pause to respect our memorial wall.
When I looked at the opening ceremony in London, they mentioned, and rightly so, the 55 people that were killed in the metro.
For friends and family of those in the stadium that cannot be here tonight, thank you.
We have had so many lame excuses over the years.
And we have, I don't know the word to say, how frustrated we are.
It's like the Bnei Israel were walking on the desert for 40 years before Moses gave them Israel, and we're 43 years after and still nothing.
43-year fight? You know, I lost all my life. I put Ilana inside. I forgot about Ilana.
One of my happiest moments was at the Olympic Games in Atlanta. There we took all the children whose father was killed. There were 14. Many of those children, like my daughter, like Ilana's daughter, they never knew their father. These kids have always lived in the shadow of the Olympics. The Olympics were always something negative, and I want to show them what they really like, the glory of the Olympics. The wonderful feeling of being at the opening ceremony and seeing all these delegations walk in and feel part of it. So we did.
I remember the Israeli delegation were on the stadium and was going with the flags and... It was like see my father and his friends.
Now, for the first time in 96, a Palestinian delegation is walking at the opening ceremony. They are not members yet, but they are observers at that point. By that time, the kids were teenagers, and I asked them, what are you going to do when the Palestinians come in? And they said, well, they're athletes, right? So we're going to applaud them too. They are not responsible for what happened then. And that was the moment that I said to myself, maybe our wish to educate them without hate in the heart, that is what came out here. This is what I see from these kids. This is what I wanted to reach this point, and I'm very happy about it. We don't hate.
Forty-three years after the chilling events of the 20th Olympiad, the Bavarian government of Germany and the International Olympic Committee, along with the Foundation for Global Sports Development, have authorized a large-scale memorial to commemorate the victims of Munich 72.
I think it's totally appropriate that the Germans recognize that event with appropriate dignity on the site where it happened, which surely is the most significant. Where else would you go in the world to put this memorial other than the place where it happened?
Current IOC President Thomas Bach, along with his fellow committee members, have for the first time acknowledged the tragedy of the Israeli Olympians of 72.
I think Thomas Bach is doing here a great move.
Mehrere Dinge tun. Wir werden an die 12 Opfer erinnern. Wir werden ihnen ihre Gesichter, ihre Lebensgeschichten wiedergeben.
What's happened is a big present for us.
They are really sorry and they're really trying to do their best now.
The fact that Germany is showing this willingness now to honor the memories of these athletes, these coaches, the policemen too, who were lost, is important.
I think it's a big step, and I think that it's about time.
It's better late than sorry. It's better that it's there.
This is what I think should have happened a long time ago, but I'm very happy that it is going to happen now, so that future generations will also understand what happened.
We have to remember who we are. We have to remember where we came from. And we also know that you have to forget. Not forget, forgive. Forgive, but not forget.